So I was praying about this, and as I was just meditating on some things, this was something that came up, and I shared it with Pastor Doug. And it's a question is, and I know I ask a lot of questions, right? But the question is, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? And that's a very relevant question for us all today. Amen. Why is that? Well, we live in a world that promotes many different belief systems and is becoming more and more intolerant to absolute truth. The world believes in many paths to God, many ways to heaven, and many expressions of God. The term relativism is a banner, or we see that it's a banner in our culture today and around the world. It can be defined as the teaching that knowledge, truth, and morality exists and change in relationship to culture, society, or historical context. It is also defined as the belief that there's no absolute truth and that only the truths that a particular person or culture happen to hold. So to sum up what relativism is, it means that a person can hold different views on morality or immorality, but all these points of views are valid and equal. So that means there's no absolute truth, there's no right and wrong. As believers in Christ, we know that the Word of God tells us there's only one way to the Father through our faith through Jesus Christ alone. We know that there's only one true and living God, which is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, three persons in one. So therefore, we understand, according to the Word of God, there's only one way to heaven. As believers, we should hold to the truth of John 14 and 6, that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one shall come into the Father except through me. Amen. So Christ is basically communicating in this scripture absolute truth. Yeah. So what is absolute truth? Well, it is something that is true at all times and in all places. It is something that is always true no matter what the circumstances are. Absolute truth is a fact that cannot be changed. So when we're teaching and preaching about Jesus Christ according to the Word of God, it's not based on our own opinion, but we are actually preaching something that is factual. We are preaching absolute truth. Amen. What Christ declared about himself was true then, is true today, and it will be true forevermore. If we look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 14, Christ said, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. If we look at the definition of narrow, it means not wide, not broad. It means not liberal, confined views, accurate. We shouldn't widen the gospel to our liking and shape it into whatever we want it to be. The gospel of Christ isn't like politics, right? According to the Word of God, there's no such thing as conservative Christians versus liberal Christians. Jesus Christ does not have two kingdoms. He has one kingdom. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6 says, there's one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. He's speaking to the church. Amen. Amen. If you define the word one, it means undivided, the same, single by union. So God's will for his church is for us to be of the same mind in regards to his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Understanding and believing who Jesus Christ is has eternity tied to it. We can either accept the truth of the nature and person of Christ, or we can reject the truth. So Christ asked his disciples this question, who do men say that I am? And before he asked them this question, there was a lot going on. We won't read it word for word, but I listed a few things that was going on before he asked them this question. Christ's teachings and works was offending the Jews and the people. John the Baptist was killed by King Herod, and King Herod thought that Christ was John the Baptist risen from the dead. You had Jesus and the disciples feeding thousands and thousands of people. Jesus had walked on water. You had the religious leaders skeptical of who he was. Jesus was healing and delivering those who were demonically possessed. So we come to the scripture of Matthew 16, verses 13 through 17. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Amen. That's this question that Jesus proposed to his disciples is still relevant for us today. Amen. It is very crucial that we are teaching the younger generation about who is Christ, who he is. If we don't teach our children, new believers in Christ, and even the church, then the culture can easily shape a false view of who he is. Amen. So the big question is, who is Jesus to you? I'm going to show two quick videos, okay, that's probably between 4 to 5 minutes, and it's going to give us an illustration of how people view Christ in the world. Okay, it's video one and then video two. Video two will stop at 1:50. We'll give it some time. Sorry about that. It's not working. No video. Okay. All right, so no problem. So no video. So let me sum up what the videos actually proclaim. So basically I was able to find some men and women who were going around sharing the gospel of Christ with others. All right? And so basically what they were doing was asking people, "Who is Jesus?" And you would have been surprised of how many people had so many different views of him. They denied that he was a son of God. They denied that he actually existed. They basically said that everybody has Jesus in them, okay, as if we're all gods. You even had some that basically believed that he's just made up something just to manipulate the masses. There was a lot of different views of who Christ was. But at the end of the day, the general lining there was they denied who he claimed to be, okay? And so that's why we're talking about who is Jesus. So some things that we can take away from the video, there's a few things listed here, and I won't read all of it, but we were able to see in the video believers in Christ fulfilling the Great Commission, okay? Just by simply asking someone, "Who is Jesus to you?" They were sharing the gospel because the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 10, verse 14, that how shall they hear without a preacher? How shall they believe on him who they have not heard? Amen. Right? We can also see just by maybe just by people that we know at our jobs, in the educational system, that the heart of mankind is naturally to reject the truth of who God is. All right? All right, and so also what we would have seen, and maybe some of us have come across people speaking certain things against Christ, maybe in the media, and that is called speaking blasphemy. So what is blasphemy? Well, it's defined as an injury offered to God by denying that which is due and belonging to him alone, or attributing to him that which is not agreeable to his nature. So when someone says, "I don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God," or they speak against his nature or who he is, they're basically committing blasphemy because they're not agreeing or they're denying something that is due to him, right? Belonging to him alone. Or when we say that I am God, then I am denying something that is only rightfully so belonging to Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. All right. So I came across an article and it really shocked me. It came across it on beliefnet.com, and it was titled, What Do Today's Teens Think About Jesus Christ? This was a national survey called the Jesus Survey, and it involved a study of faith and experience as it relates to the lives of Christian teens. This survey dealt with four core beliefs in the Christian faith. One, the Bible is trustworthy in what it says about Jesus. Two, Jesus is God. Three, Jesus lived, died, and was resurrected from the dead. And four, Jesus is the only way to heaven. And this wasn't a part of this group, but I wanted to add this to it as well, that we're only saved by faith alone in Christ and not by works. Okay? But this is what the survey discovered. Are you ready? Yep. All right. Number one, it says one in ten Christian teens indicated a confident belief in all four of these core beliefs. One in ten. The other 90 to 91% expressed differences and sometimes disbelief in one or more of these core beliefs. That is very high. Only 39% of Christian teens express strong confidence that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Based on the video and on these stats, okay, we are able to realize that there's a spiritual war going on for the souls of mankind. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 5 says, But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, referring to the devil, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is an image of God, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. So Satan is working overtime to blind the hearts of men, women, and children from the absolute truth of who Christ is. What's so ironic, and the Lord showed me this, what's so ironic is that the enemy and his demons know who Christ is. They know who he is, but they are wanting to keep the lost and professing Christians from knowing the absolute truth of who Christ is. How do I know this? Let's look at scripture real quick. If we look at Mark chapter 5, verses 6 through 10, it says, When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him. And he cried out with a loud voice and said, What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me. For he said to him, Come out of the man, unclean spirit. Then he asked him, this is Christ speaking now, What is your name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. Also, he begged him earnestly that he would not send them out of the country. So real quick, we see here a man who is possessed by a legion of demons bow down at the feet of Jesus Christ. He recognized that he was a son of God and knew that Christ had the power and authority to judge and to torment him. Okay? James 2 and 19 says, You believe there is one God. You do well, even the demons believe and tremble. So even the demons believe that there's one God. They know that there's not many gods. Now, they're trying to deceive people into believe there's many gods, but they know that there's only one. Matthew chapter 4, verses 5 through 7, Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your feet against a stone. So here again, Satan himself tries to tempt Christ to sin. He knew that he was the Son of God, but he was trying to get him to sin and to worship him, which we know Christ passed that temptation. Amen. So so what we will understand that Satan basically twisted Psalms 91 verses 11 through 12. So he's twisting scripture today. He's twisting the word of God today to try to pervert absolute truth of who Christ is. He knows there's only one God. He knows that there's only one way to the Father. He knows that there's not many ways to heaven. But due to his extreme hate for God and for mankind, he is doing everything that he can to blind the world. If the enemy is unsuccessful in completely keeping us away from truth about who Jesus Christ is, he would then seek to distort or to pervert who Christ is to us. If we look at the word distort, it means to twist out of the true meaning, to alter, to give a false or unnatural picture or account. Pervert means to turn from the truth or from its proper use, to distort from its true use, to corrupt, to pervert reason by misinterpreting and misapplying them. So 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4 says, "For if he who comes preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit, which you have not received, or a different gospel, which you have not accepted, you may well put up with it." Galatians 1, verses 6 through 7 says, "I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another. But there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ." So we are warned by Paul, the Apostle Paul, that there's only one Jesus, right? There's only one gospel. Amen. And we cannot separate Jesus Christ from his gospel. The good news is proclaiming who Christ is and what he's done to save us. Amen? Amen. So there's multiple distortions of Christ because the enemy is working overtime, as I said, right? So I only wanted to give us two examples that I would like to share today of a distortion of Christ. The first one is that Christ is the God of mammon or riches. If we define the word of mammon, it means it refers to wealth, money, property, material possessions. In biblical culture, mammon can be described as all lusts or excesses, such as gluttony, greed, and dishonest worldly gain, an idol of materialism. So some scholars cite mammon as the name of a Syrian or Chaldean god, similar to the Greek god of wealth, Plutus. So a person who is influenced by a spirit of mammon will illustrate selfish ambition. Okay, Galatians 5:23 tells us that a person who practices selfish ambition will not inherit the kingdom of God. Luke 16:13 says, "No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other." You cannot serve God in mammon. So what mammon does, it has us to focus on the now. But instead of, Christ wants us to look towards eternity, to his coming kingdom and eternity with him. Amen? Amen. So is Christ saying that as his followers that we're not supposed to have anything? No. Let us look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. It says, "Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life." So the scripture tells us we will either despise the one and love the other. So when we have a spirit of mammon, we would despise those who give of their property, that give of their wealth or their material possessions to others. We won't understand why they're doing that. Or we may despise giving of our own, right? And so we can't serve two masters. The second one, a second distortion of Christ, some people view Christ as if he's just about love and nothing else. Now, we didn't get a chance to watch the videos, but some of the people were saying that when they were asking them, "Who is Jesus to you?" And they said, "Well, he's not judgmental, or he's loving, or he's just a symbol of love," which he loves us very much, right? We understand that. But when I mentioned earlier about what distort means, we have to be careful to not paint just one side of him, right, which can present an unnatural picture or an account of Jesus as if he doesn't care about sin, right? In Roman mythology, Cupid represented the god of love in their culture. And he would use a bow and arrow, and he would shoot love wherever he wanted to go, right? But the love that Christ demonstrated to the world is different than the love of Cupid. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says, "But God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 10 says, "In this the love of God was manifested towards us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Amen. That word propitiation means basically the atoning sacrifice offered to God to appease his wrath, to satisfy his wrath, and render him propitious to sinners. Romans 6 and 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Amen. So Christ loved us enough to lay down his life to pay the full penalty of our sins, right? So that, and to satisfy the wrath of God by dying on a cross, shedding his blood, being resurrected from the grave, so that we do not have to experience the wrath of God. He offered us the free gift of salvation, the free gift of eternal life. Amen?
Amen.
Also, Christ is going, he's the judge. He's going to judge the church. He's going to judge the lost. So he is also a judge. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 5 through 10, and I won't read all of that for the sake of time, so we'll start at verse 7. It says, "And to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord, from the glory of his power, when he comes in that day, to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed." So who is Jesus Christ? And we'll go through this quickly. We discovered what men say about him. We've probably heard some things online, on Facebook, people denying that Christ existed, denying that he actually lived, denying that he is God, right? So the first thing is that Jesus was God manifested in the flesh. He is the Son of God. He was God incarnate. He was fully God and fully man. If we ever want to know this, if we're speaking to someone and God is leading us to share the gospel, every false religion is going to attack the person and the nature of Jesus Christ. They would not admit that he is the Son of God. Amen. If we look at Philippians 2 verses 5 through 8 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men." So saying he was fully God, he was fully man. "And being found in an appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." John chapter 10, verse 33, "The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, and because you, being a man, capital M, make yourself God." So this is something else that was ironic. Christ was claiming to be God, and he gave them so many clues and used scripture to give them clues that he was God in the flesh. Okay, but here you have the Jews and the religious leaders did not believe that he was the Son of God. Okay, so they were basically accusing him of a sin that they were committing themselves. Okay, they were committing the sin of blasphemy, right? And that's why Christ called them, you know, he's very harsh. You know, he called them hypocrites because they did not see that the very sin they was committing, they were accusing him of. Basically, they did not give him the due that was due to him, that he was God and that he came to save the world. Amen? Amen. The next thing, his birth was prophesied about 700 years before the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 9 and 6 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." He was born in Bethlehem of Judea during the time of the Roman Empire, which we cannot deny Roman civilization. So he actually lived. You can refer to Matthew 2 and verse 1. We'll go to the next one. He was hated without a cause. We'll skip Psalm 69 and 4, but if we look at John chapter 15, verses 23 through 25, it says, "He who hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which no one else did, they would have no sin. But now they have seen and also hated both me and my Father. But this happened that the word might be fulfilled, which is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. Referencing Psalm 69 and 4. We still see that today. People hating Jesus don't even know why they hate him, right? And that's why we have to pray for him and show them the love of Jesus. Amen. Amen. The next one is, Jesus was perfect, sinless. He fulfilled the law of God perfectly. Hebrews 4 and 15 says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. So we know that the law was given to Moses, right? And the law was given to bring a knowledge of sin to show that we all are guilty before God, a righteous and a perfect and holy God, and that none of us could keep the laws of God perfectly without sin, all right? And so it demonstrated that God was holy and that he's righteous and he's going to judge those according to his word. Next, Jesus was born of a virgin and conceived of the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 7 and 14 says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Amen. He offered up himself as a sacrifice for sin once and for all. Hebrews 7, 26 and 27, we won't read all of that, but basically what it is saying, Christ died once and for all. He doesn't have to continue to die over and over again and be resurrected over and over again. He shed his blood once and for all. It pays the full penalty of our sins, and we can trust and have confidence that we are saved by the grace of God through our faith in him. Amen. Amen. Next, Christ is eternal. John chapter 8, verses 58 says, Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Man, this is something that they should have caught on to. He's referencing Exodus 3 and 14. He's basically, again, claiming to be God, right? He's saying, before Abraham was, I am. So if we look at that, it says, and God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. He's claiming that he is eternal. Amen. Amen. There are no other gods besides him. Isaiah 45 and 5. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me. Next point. Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. There are not many sons of God in the world. There's only one begotten Son. Amen. John 3 and 18 says, he who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So we use that a lot when we say we believe in the name of Jesus Christ. It basically means when we say we believe in the name of Christ, we are saying we believe in his reputation, in his character, in his distinction, and in his authority. Amen. Next point, Jesus created all things. Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 says, for by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. So this is also showing his eternal status and that Christ is God. He had no beginning. He has no end. He was not created. Amen? Amen. The next point is, he is the only mediator between God and man. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So basically, there's no other means by which we can be saved. Jesus Christ provided the means by laying down his life, and he is the only one that can bring us to the Father. Amen. Amen. The next one is, we cannot have the Father without believing in his Son. Right? So one thing when I would go and preach to the in the juvenile detention center, one of the things I will make sure that they understood that you cannot have God without believing in his Son, right? Because some would say, well, I believe in God, right? And they're like, okay, well, do you believe in Jesus? No, I don't believe in Jesus. Well, there's only one God. You can't have the Father without the Son. Amen. Amen. And so if we look at scripture, it tells us that. It says 1 John chapter 2, verse 23 says, whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Why? Because they are one. Amen. Next, Christ lived on the earth. We can refer to John chapter 1, verse 14. It tells us that the Word became flesh. The next point is Christ is greater than Satan. Right? So they're not equal. They're not on the same playing field. They will never be on the same playing field. If we look at Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, it says, the devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now, this is something that's going to happen in the future. But the reason why I brought this scripture is to show that Christ is able to judge and has judged Satan already. So if they were equal, he would not be able to judge him. He would be able to resist Jesus Christ, which he cannot because Christ is greater. Amen. The next point is he overcame the power of death. All right. So we won't read all of it, but Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 15 says that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through the fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. And we're almost done. Next point, Jesus was resurrected from the grave. Matthew chapter 28, verses 5 through 7. But the angel answered and said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Amen. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. After he was resurrected from the grave, the Bible tells us, which is our next point, that he was ascended into heaven. Acts chapter 1, verses 9 through 11 says, now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up. A cloud received him out of their sight, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Well, what were they saying? And that brings us to our last point about who is Jesus Christ. He's coming again. Amen. Amen. That is a promise, and we can believe that that is absolute truth. Amen. That is a fact. It's not an opinion. It is not a myth. That's right. Jesus Christ is coming again. Amen. Revelation chapter 1, verse 7 says, behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. So due to the enemy's agenda to deceive the world, that's why we have been given the Great Commission, which is the chief task of the church. Amen. Amen. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 says, and he said to them, go into all of the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So who is Jesus? Who do we believe him to be? Do we believe the world? Do we believe what men say? Do we believe what our friends say about him if they deny him? Do we believe maybe even our family? Maybe our family deny who he is. Maybe the college professor, right? Maybe some organizations that we're a part of deny who he is, right? Maybe our culture, right? Maybe our family tradition, maybe our culture ancestors deny who he is. Who will we believe? Will we believe in the words of Jesus Christ, or will we believe what men say about him? And this is our last scripture, I promise. We look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. This is Christ speaking. He says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock, referring to Jesus Christ. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was his fall. Who is Jesus? I think we found out just a little bit about him, but there's much more to discover about who he is in the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Do we know him? And that is a question. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, we just thank you, Lord, so much for your word. God, we just thank you, Lord, that your word is powerful, it's living, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, and is able to do the work that you have set it forth to do in this world, in this place, in our lives, in our hearts, in our minds. And God, help us to do your will. Help us to not be afraid to declare who Christ is to us. Help us to not be afraid to be a witness, to share the testimony of God, of his Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that we are here to worship you. And I pray for this church. I pray for those who are watching online, Lord, that if they do not happen to truly know who you are, that the Holy Spirit is working on them to draw them to you. You said if you be lifted up, that you would draw all men unto you. So we thank you and we give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Now that we talked about Jesus, there's an opportunity that if someone does not know him, you can come to him by faith alone. You know, a quick story that I use a lot is, you know, when Christ was on the cross and he's being crucified, right? During the Roman times, that's how they executed criminals. And I believe they did those who were not considered Roman citizens that way. All right? And so Christ is on the cross. You had a criminal on the side of him to the right, and you had another criminal on the left. Right? And so you had one criminal that mocked and rejected Christ. And then you had the other criminal that actually recognized and believed in the name of Jesus. He recognized his character, his reputation, his distinction, and his authority. And he knew that Christ could save him. That criminal was not going to get off that cross that day. He was going to die. But he knew that Christ had the power to save him. And you know what he said to Christ? He said, Lord, please remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Christ didn't say, it's too late. He didn't do that. He said, no, you're a criminal. You deserve what you get. He said, this day you shall be with me in paradise. So that criminal, he did not get a chance to get off that cross and go make amends with everybody in his life. He didn't get a chance to get off that cross and go to rehab. He didn't get a chance to get off that cross and go and find out the purpose that God had for his life. He didn't get a chance to get off that cross and go to church. He didn't get a chance to do that, but it's because of his faith in Christ that he knew that he was the Son of God, that he was saved and justified in the sight of God that day. Amen? And so that is for someone here today, whether you're watching online or in this place right now, that we are justified by our faith alone in Christ, not by works. There's nothing that we can do that can make us right in the sight of God. And if that is you today, I want you to pray with me, okay? Father God in heaven, we love you, we honor you, and we bless your holy name. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that he was God manifested in the flesh, that he died for me, that he was buried, and that he rose from the grave on the third day. It is because of him that I can be set free from the bondage of sin. It's because of Jesus that I am able to live a new life in him. I believe in your death, burial, and resurrection. Please forgive me of all of my sins. And I turn away from my old life and I embrace my new life in you. Thank you for my eternal life and my salvation, which is only found in you. In Jesus' name, amen.